Unitary couple cluster theory is the one that usually comes to mind to anyone who want to try to do electronic structure on a quantum computer. And it's a simple looking expression, but not very simply implementable in the quantum computer because it has the exponent of a relatively complicated anti-Hermitian operator. And in order to put it on a quantum computer, you need somehow to present it as a product of or sequence of simple gates, and that is not very simple. So in this video, I would like to talk about some subtleties related to breaking down this expression into pieces that are implementable on a quantum computer, because those manipulations sometimes lead to the theories that are not in principle exact. All right, so how do we build unitary coupled cluster theory? So we start with the one electron picture where we have occupied and unoccupied orbitals. And then we can construct our single excitation, double excitation, and up to n-tuple excitations. But in practice, usually people stay within the singles and doubles because of just simply powers of the current quantum computers are not even high enough to handle those two. At any rate, so these excitations, they are not Hermitian or anti-Hermitian operators. So in order to build the unitary operator, you need an anti-exponentiate anti-Hermitian operator. And in order to get anti-Hermitian operator, you need to add to every excitation the Hermit conjugated part, or subtract really literally here. And when we do that, turns out that we break commutativity. What this means is that any excitation actually commutes with other excitations. And that's nice because then exponent of the sum would be able to, one would be able to translate as a product of exponents. But once we added the de-excitation, then the commutativity is broken and the exponent of the sum is not simply a product of exponents. And so that kind of somewhat prevents us to simply take the exponent of that giant sum and put in a quantum computer and essentially implement it. So there are some tricks I needed. Okay, one of those basic tricks is trotterization. And the way it works for the single and double level of theory, but you can continue to the higher level of theory, which just elongates the expression. So what we do here, let's just introduce this kappa operators that will be a short notation for excitation minus de-excitation, singles and doubles. And then what trotter approximation does, it breaks down the exponent of the sum into the multiple products of exponents, right? And here you repeat singles and doubles several times. The large K defines how many times you repeat. And if you want the exact representation, then you need to do it infinitely many times. Of course, in practice, no one can do infinitely many times those operations. And well, in most of the cases, people settle on the K equals one. So just essentially breakdown of the exponent of the sum as a sequence of products of the exponents. What is interesting is that because of the non-commutativity of individual operators, the way you put them in that sequence of products of exponents may matter for the result. And interestingly, there is no order dependence in the case where you reshuffle the singles among the single excitation, the excitations, but there is an order dependence within the two electron or the double excitations, the excitations. And we'll return to that point in a moment. Now, before we do that, it turns out that you can actually get to this product of singles and double excitations, the excitations, even without trotter approximation. So the way to do it, and that's sometimes called disentangled unitary coupled clusters. So what you can do is to do this unitarization, namely adding the excitation, starting with the product of exponents of excitation operators. So this is a normal wave operator and couple cluster singles and doubles, it contains only excitations and they all commute, so you can reshuffle them in whichever way you want. Now, every exponent can be turned into the unitary operator by essentially subtracting the excitation part in the exponent, right? So turning into a kappa operators. So that way you can just simply get the product of the exponents, and those will be unitary operators. And so no trotter is needed to do that. Great. But it turns out that these expressions will be even more order dependent than the one that we obtain using trotter approximation for a large case at least. Okay, so now the question could be, how big is the difference between different orders? Well, there is this work where it was studied for the level of singles and doubles and ST of 3G for relatively small model systems. How big is the difference between the different orders? And it was found that, say, for nitrogen, which is one of these systems that people are interested in because it's a strongly correlated system, that the difference could be quite substantial. And that essentially tells you that if you want to report the data where you used this disentangled unitary coupled cluster theory, you need to specify what order of operators did you use in this product of exponents. But it turns out that just the numerical differences between the orders is not the worst thing about this disentangled version. In this work, where just a simple model system was considered, here we looked at the just two electrons on the two orbitals, and the entire space is just containing this four Slater determinants, right? Because there's no other ways you can put two electrons on two orbitals. But you can formulate the disentangled unitary coupled cluster theory in different ways, meaning that you can take different orders. So you have two single rotations, essentially, kappa with the IA and the IA with the different spin components, right? And the double excitation, the excitation. So you can put the singles first, acting on the, say, your Hartree-Fock Slater determinant, and doubles last, or you can put the double between the two singles, the two orders. And because those are the only excitations, the excitations in the in this model system, one could think that using those and optimizing the amplitudes T1, T2, T3, you can essentially obtain any wave function that you can come up with using those four Slater determinants. And in the work, this linear combination of Slater determinants was sought. And turns out that no matter how you optimize the T1, T2, T3, if you put the singles first and then doubles, you can actually not reach this wave function, okay? Natural question is, what's wrong with this set of operators, right? Because it seems like it's complete. It has all the excitations, the excitations that you can possibly construct in this system. So what is wrong? We cannot generate an arbitrary state with that. So it seems like we are not really able to construct any state within the subspace. Okay, in order to answer that question, we need to look a little bit deeper into the mathematical structure of the unitary transformations, which are nicely described by this Lie algebras and Lie groups, named for Norwegian mathematician Sophus Lie. And Lie algebras is just a set of operators, I call them P's here, and they have just a closure relation in the sense that if you take two non-commuting operators and construct a commutator, it can be always expressed as a linear combination of operators from the same set, right? So that closure, the inability to go outside of the algebra by making the commutators, That's what makes the set of linear operators also a Lie algebra. And turns out that if you work with relatively nice cases that we are dealing with, namely compact Lie algebras and Lie groups, it turns out that it's possible to write a Lie group as a product of exponents of corresponding Lie algebra elements, like assuming that the operators are Hermitian, then you have these exponents that give you product of the unitary operators, and they form Lie group. In Lie group, we have a product closure, meaning that no matter what elements of the group you take, what unitary operators you take, if you multiply them, you cannot go outside of the group. And there is this parameter taus that you can change for different elements. But any element of Lie group can be presented as a product of a corresponding exponent of Lie algebra operators. Sometimes the Lie algebra operators are called group generators. All right, so what's use of this structure we can make? It turns out that, say, if we have three operators that don't commute, P1, P2, P3, then in this case, if you exponentiate a linear combination of those, any of two or all three, doesn't really matter, you cannot write this exponent of a sum as a product of exponents. But because exponent of a sum will be a sum element of a Lie group, if you choose the coefficients here, say purely imaginary for the Hermitian P1, P2, then it turns out if you put the product of all three elements of Lie algebra, then it will be enough to present any exponent. And also, you can actually change the order of P1, P2, P3 in these products. You can choose P1, P3, P2. The only price you pay for changing the order is you need to adjust the amplitudes or coefficients in the exponents. And that's all. You will be able to generate, essentially, or reshuffle things and readjust the coefficients. That's what essentially closure relations allow you to do in these structures. The bottom line, if you want to avoid order problem, then you can just simply take your operators from Lie algebra and then constructing the all possible exponents with the Lie algebra elements in the exponents, then you can construct any group element, any unitary operator. All right, so that's great. But what the downside of that procedure is that if you have two operators, say, and you decided, okay, I want to include all the Lie algebra elements, then I'll take the the commutators of those two operators, and then whatever will be produced, I will take the commutator of that with the original two, and so on and so forth. As long as I keep producing the new elements, I'll keep doing that. But that may create a lot of operators. So essentially could lead to algebraic explosion. Now, one way to somewhat reduce the number of operators in the set, if you are interested in molecular problems, then you have Hamiltonian symmetries. And what you can do is you can add extra constraint that the operators that you're generating, they must commute with the symmetry operators so that they can eventually be used to generate functions which are also eigenfunctions of the symmetry operators. Now, that's one way to somewhat reduce the growth of the number of operators and when you do the all possible commutators. One worry you can have is that, will you still get the closed algebras if you consider symmetry adapted operators? It turns out that there is this nice relation coming from the following expression for the commutators, nested commutators. And what the operator S here is, like, let's say one of the symmetry operator. And if we have symmetry adapted operators P's, then they commute with symmetry. And means that this commutator is zero. Naturally, the entire thing is zero here. This commutator is zero, and then the entire thing is zero here. And then what this means is the symmetry adapted operator, commuting with symmetry adapted operator, produces something that, because the whole thing is zero, will also commute by construction with the symmetry operator. So naturally, symmetry adapted operators will also create the algebras. Okay, so returning back to the our example with two electron two orbital model, what we have here is these three operators, and it turns out, we checked that in our publication here, that these three operators, they don't form a Lie algebra. Essentially, if you commute them with each other, they produce more operators, five more to be exact. And then only with eight in total, you can produce the Lie algebra. And of course, it's not fun to go from three operators to eight. So what we did in our work, we decided, okay, well, why don't we use symmetries to reduce the set of operators? And indeed, we were able to trim it down to four operators. You can see that these are some linear combination of the original operators and maybe times the occupation number operators, which are necessary to make a closure. And there are only four because we make those operators to commute with the symmetries. Turns out you can reduce it even further because one linear combination of elements from this four operator set is commuting with everything. So it's a central element and it's only introducing extra phase in the function. But the three which are listed here, they form SO3 or SU2, which are isomorphic algebras, and they are enough to put in any order in order to get any function in the whole space. So this is the kind of the resolution of this problem, model problem with two electrons and two orbitals. You essentially need to make sure your operators are forming Lie algebra, and then you can be sure that they will be able to generate functions from the space that you are working in. All right, so more on fermionic based algebras. If we look at the fermionic operators, turns out that only single orbital rotations, excitations and de-excitations, form the closed algebra. And also all possible excitations and de-excitation among M orbitals form the closed algebra. Anything in between, like doubles, triples, they don't form closed algebras. Why is that? Here's a simple kind of illustration that singles with singles, if you commute, they will go and give you either zero if they indeed commute, or they give another singles. Double and single is fine, it gives you double, but double with double gives you at most triple excitation, the excitations, and those essentially triple with triple will give you like a fifth power or excitation, the excitation. And in general, n tuple with m tuple gives you n plus m minus one, right? And so we don't have really a closure if we go to the level of doubles. But there is a nice feature here then, is that it's enough to have only singles and doubles to generate all if you allow the all possible commutations happening in that set. Another interesting thing about fermionic excitations, de-excitations, is that by construction, the ones that just have a just elementary excitation, de-excitation, they conserve number of electrons and as z, but they don't conserve necessarily as square. In order to make a symmetry conserving operators, you need the linear combinations of fermionic rotations, like in this case for the singles. And if we just look at the elementary single or multiple, actually n-tuple excitations, the excitations, then they produce Pauli products when we go to the qubit space. And generally, depending on the level of excitation, the excitation and the number of power is produced growing exponentially. So it's just 2 for single level, 8 for double already, and 32 for triple. So it grows very quickly, which is unpleasant for the constructing a circuit. Now, the nice feature though is that Pauli products that are coming from those from usual mappings, that those Paulis they usually commute, and so there are techniques how to do circuits somewhat shallower because of that commutativity, and so this is can be exploited. To summarize, the original expression that everyone is kind of thinking about when you say unitary coupled cluster theory, at least in the classical electronic structure community, it's order independent. So you can really change things in the exponent here because it's an exponent of a giant sum. It's exact if you don't truncate the level of excitation here. And it has a high accuracy if you truncate it, but then it's inaccessible for quantum computer because you can simply cannot just ask quantum computer to introduce the unitary that is the exponent of a giant operator. Yeah, you need to present it as a product of gates or product of simple unitary transformations. Now, if you operate with the product of exponents, say go singles, doubles, and so on. In order to construct this or come to this form, you don't need the Trotter approximation. You can simply just do the unitarization of the classical coupled cluster operator. It's not exact though, and it's order dependent. And so to make these expressions potentially exact, you need to take the algebraic closure of all the operators that are present. And that leads to so-called generalized unitary coupled cluster theory that has not only excitation and de-excitation operators, but maybe occupation number operators involved. So that's the story with this disentangled form, essentially. And if you'd like to reduce the operators that are involved, you can potentially reduce them to just a single double fermionic rotations, because as you remember, those operators, if you do the commutations of doubles, they can and singles, they can produce any other level excitations, de-excitations. So in order to do that, you need to be able to repeat those operators. So there will be multiple doubles, multiple singles. Without this repetition, you won't be able to be potentially exact. And if you would like to reduce the type of operators that you use in the exponents, then you can potentially use symmetry adapted generators. They will be generating higher circuit depths because individual operators will be just linear combination of some singles and doubles and higher order maybe. And so, but they will allow you to conserve the symmetries at every step of your transformation that tries to prepare a wave function, which is not really necessary because after all, what we care about is that the wave function produced at the end needs to be a symmetrical wave function because we know that the true wave function is symmetrical. But at every step, you don't need to conserve symmetry. And that's something that we exploit a lot in the qubit coupled cluster theory that produces very efficient circuits by breaking symmetry of number electrons on each step. But overall, it will converge to the true state with the proper number of electrons because that's what variational principle essentially driving things into.